Welcome to the backup video of the paper presentation of history-based specification and verification of Java collections in Qi. This is joint work with Yinting Bian, Frank de Boer and Stijn de Gaal, and to be presented at the IFM conference 2020. So let's give first a little bit of context of our work. Software libraries, such as the Java Collection Framework, are important building blocks. If there is an error in a widely used library, such as the Java Collection Framework, this might affect lots of other programs that use it. And so it's our ultimate goal to verify the Java Collection Framework. Previous work has shown that there are actually bugs inside the Java Collection Framework. For instance, in the linked list implementation, there is an integer overflow bug. But before we can continue this work of the full verification of Java Collection Framework, it is necessary to be able to specify, give a specification of the collection interface itself. Now, there is some related work on the verification on Java collections and collection implementations. But the main question we have is, how do you actually verify a client of an interface? And by client of an interface, I mean a piece of program that makes use of an object that implements an interface. And since you do not know what implementation you're dealing with, how can you verify the usage of such an interface? Well, we use the state-of-the-art theorem prover, Qi. And Qi is a theorem prover, so it does not execute the program under analysis. It is the only tool, as far as we know, that actually can load Java code. So it has enough features of the language, such as exceptions, control flow, interruption, that allows us to load the actual implementation of the Java Collection Framework as provided by OpenJDK. It uses the JML language, Java Modeling Language, to annotate methods, giving them contracts. And a contract of a method specifies the pre and post conditions. And moreover, it uses the Java dynamic logic to symbolically execute program fragments. And these two together allow you to statically reason about the program correctness of Java programs. So to make matters a bit more concrete, let's consider two challenges. The first challenge is as given. Suppose you're given a collection and an object. If you now add the object to the collection, and that succeeds, and then you remove the same object from the collection, then what we expect is that the contents of the collection is not affected by these operations. It is indeed the case that add returns true whenever the collection is modified. So if, for instance, the add method returns false, then the collection wasn't modified, so we also expect the contents to be the same. The second challenge is shown now. So how can we now, in this example, show that this example terminates? So given a collection, how can we now establish that after iterating over the collection, only finitely many steps are taken? So the key issues we encountered in this work was that Qi and Java DL in particular allow very much state-based reasoning. But the whole point of interfaces is that they hide the state, so that you do not have access to the concrete state under the particular consideration. So the main issue with specification is how do we, and that is always the issue, translate informal requirements as, for instance, provided by the Java documentation of the collections, but also, and more importantly, what is a suitable formalism for formulating how these informal requirements should be implemented by an implementation of an interface. And then we have two sides of the verification. One side is, given an implementation of an interface, is it correct with respect to a specification given for the interface? And the other side is, given a client of an interface, can we verify that it is correct with respect to the given specification? And of course, there are some tooling issues and encoding issues when we have to deal with key, as I will tell you a little bit later. So the approach we take is based on histories. Now, histories are known already from runtime verification tools. And the main idea of a history is that we record for a particular interface all the method invocations that have happened on that interface in an associated history. Now, we can then define abstractions over this history. So they allow us to formulate abstract properties based purely on the history of the method calls performed on an interface. And then we use these abstract properties to specify the object behavior. So that is the behavior of the objects that implement the interface. Now, the general approach that we have taken is applicable to all interfaces, but here we specifically focus on the collection interface to make matters concrete. The point is, there is no built-in support for reasoning about histories in neither Key nor JML. So we have to deal with these situations by encoding histories to allow reasoning in Key about them. So to make matters a bit more concrete, here you have an example. Below, you see an empty history, so that is represented by null. And now for every method call you perform on a particular interface, so in this case collection X, we will record this by adding an event. And a history we can see as a sequence of events. So suppose we call on X the add method with the object Y, and it returns true, then we record the add event with the same parameter and the return value. Now, suppose then thereafter we call again add, but with a different argument, with z, which also returns true. We again record this by adding an event to the sequence. And this goes on for other events as well, such as the remove method call. So now that we know what a history is, being a sequence of events, we can understand what an abstract property of the history is. And in the case of collection, it is important that we have this informal notion of what its contents is. And we can formalize this by considering the contents of a collection as a multiset. A multiset assigns to each element a multiplicity, meaning how many times this element occurs in the collection. So we can define, given a particular history, a multiset inductively over that history. So for the empty history, we can say the multiset is empty. And now whenever we encounter an add event which returns true, we can say, well, then it must be the case that the contents of the collection has been extended by adding that object to the collection. So the multiplicity increases. However, if the add method returned false, then the contents of the collection is not affected. So the multiset remains the same with respect to the past history. The same thing applies to the remove event, but now we remove the object. So that means we decrease the multiplicity by one. And in the case that the remove method returned false, then the collection is not affected. So we recurse in the tail of the history, etc. for other events. And now, of course, we had to deal with a number of issues with the tooling and encoding in Key. For example, to work with these attributes, we have to define them as pure side effect free methods that cannot affect the heap. But also we have to prove that these attributes are deterministic, which means that computing these attributes is deterministic and that they terminate. And now other technical issues came up as well. For instance, the footprint of a history is needed to reason about it. But let's keep the technical issues aside now. Now that we know what a history is, and now that we know what a particular abstraction such as the multiset of a history is, and how can we specify the behavior of interface methods using these histories and their abstraction? So let's say we have here the method that is part of the interface, add. The contract of this method is specified by giving preconditions and postconditions. So let's take as a preconditions that the history before calling the method is freezed in the age-old variable, so that we can then later refer to it in the post condition. Whenever we call a particular method, it is expected that the history, of course, is also updated. So whenever we refer to age in the post condition, it is an updated history, because the call to the object is now also recorded into it. So what we can expect as a post condition of this method is that the multiset attribute de multiset property of the history for the given argument is potentially increased. And this potency depends on the resulting Boolean returned by the add method. So if it returns true, then indeed the multiplicity of O is increased by 1, and if it returns false, then the multiplicity remains the same. Moreover, we can state that the intention of calling add is that the object is part of the collection after it has returned. So we say that the multiset of the after the method has returned, so of the updated history, must be positive. And also we can state that for any other object, so that is not equal to the argument, the multiplicity remains the same. Now, you can ask yourself, if this is, abstractly speaking, how we specify the interface methods, is it also possible to specify an interface with specifications that are in some sense inconsistent, meaning that there does not actually exist a correct implementation with that satisfies that specification? And yes, this is possible. So in the paper, we explain how you can show that the specification is consistent by witnessing a so-called reference implementation and proving that the reference implementation is correct with respect to the specification. Also, you might notice that the result of the method, so the return value of the method, in this contract is underspecified. It is not specified whether the result is true or false. Why is this so? So to see why that is the case, let's consider that the collection interface is the topmost interface in the hierarchy of the collection framework. So it is extended by both the set and the list interface. Now, as an example, suppose we're given a collection with an empty history, so that we know that the history multiset property is that every object that it is empty, there is no object in it. But now suppose two possible things in parallel. Suppose that X was a set, and suppose, on the other hand, that X is a list. Right? We now consider two possible possibilities. Now, whenever we add some object to the collection, we know that the return value must be true. Why? Because it was empty, and one of the postconditions is that the multiplicity afterwards is guaranteed to be positive. So it must return true, otherwise it cannot increase the multiplicity of the argument. But then there is a difference between the set and the list, because the set does not allow you to add the same element more than once. But a list also always allows you to add some elements. So the return value in set is false, but the return value in list is true. So we must leave the return value unspecified on the level of collection, because otherwise we cannot refine it into a set or into a list. Moreover, it should be also remarked that the return value of a method is thus not a function of the past history and the method arguments. Although this is what you intuitively expect, a particular method computes the return value. This is not the case in the perspective of collection. It is the case for set. It is the case for list. But on the higher level of abstraction, this is not the case. So there our underspecification is revealed. Now, to be more specific, set refines the collection, so it actually makes sure that the multiplicity of every object is always bounded, so it is never higher than one. And the list is another different refinement of the collection. It makes sure that whenever you want to add an element to the list, it always returns true, it's always possible. And then you can ask yourself, yeah, but the list also has additional information, like the ordering of elements, where does it get this? Well, because they share the same history, the history is a recording of all events, in the list you can also recover the order of, for instance, the order of how the elements were added to make sure that the elements remain in order, while for sets this is not important. So I will now touch upon very briefly on iterators, which is an advanced topic involving subobjects. And the whole idea of a subobject is that a subobject shares its history with its so-called owner. So iterators allow you to iterate over collections, and the iterators share their history with the collection that they come from. So now whenever you call methods on the iterator, these methods are not recorded in its own history because it doesn't have it, it's recorded in the history of the collection. And now we can define a property of the multiset of the iterator of a collection. And this must be a submultiset of the collection. You can think of this as the multiset of all the visited elements so far. And then you can define abstract properties such as a collection size being the sum of all the multiplicities and the iterator size being the sum of all the multiplicities that are visited. This allows us to give a decreasing term allowing to complete the termination argument. In conclusion, what we have seen is that it is feasible in Key to do history-based specification and verification. We namely gave a specification of part of the collection interface and verified its consistency. And we also verified some clients, for example, the two challenges given at the beginning. The contribution of this work is a particular approach to specification and verification, namely based on histories, which is general enough to be applied on all Java interfaces. And future work allows is in the direction of adding histories into Key on a more primitive level. We currently encode histories as Java objects, and this is making reasoning about them impractical. We want to extend Key to have histories as an inductive data type. And this allows us to continue the verification of the Java collection framework, in particular the add all, remove all, retain all methods. And finally, this is the first step towards a general framework for behavioral refinement for Java interfaces. By the way, the article, code, and we also have video material are all freely available. Thank you.